What we found is that the more institutionalized religions really have got the umbrella group concept down. So, you know, if you look at the Jews, you not only have the federations, which are essentially umbrella organizations, but you also have essentially, you know, member benefit organizations for all of the Jewish community centers, all of the Jewish employment networks, all of the, you know, you name it, you've got it, plus the Jewish social workers, plus the, you know, and what you get from these organizations is a huge amount of material on, you know, and formal programs. I mean, they're running leadership programs, et cetera. The Catholics, Catholic Charities USA, Catholic Healthcare Association, et cetera. The more mainline Protestant-y you get, the less likely you're going to see umbrellas, and the evangelicals have the fewest of them. And I think they have different purposes. I mean, for example, Friends Services for the Aging is providing quality assurance the state requires for its member organizations, plus variations on the theme of insurance. So, you know, they're doing a lot of different things, and this is one function of many.
Congregational systems are where individual worship communities or groups of a faith, a judicatory, for example, will together sponsor a nonprofit. And most of the Protestant churches in the country are congregational in their form. They vary whether they have bishops or are independent, you know, so they vary in the level of whether it's a group or individual. And even the Quakers, where the service organizations are usually found by individual meetings, the systems that serve them are corporate systems of national. So it's not a totally one-way system. It's not just individual worship communities. There also are networked communities. Well, we'll talk about that. Community-wide organizations that come out of congregational systems are usually sponsored interfaith or by a congregational coalition who might serve as the first line of support and guidance. And in this case, for example, there's an organization in Baltimore called GEDCO, Govan's Ecumenical Development Community Organization, which is the churches in a geographic area that have joined together to serve that geographic area. And the churches appoint members of the board so that it's very congregationally based. And they have gotten into community development in terms of building housing for the lower economic level, and also for a middle level that the state funding doesn't handle very well. So they also have sponsored service living arrangements for people who have special needs. So they have a special care center, for example. And this organization, as an ecumenical group, can do a lot more than any one of those congregations could do on their own. Lots more. I mean, my friend's meeting, which is pretty big, I mean, has 400 members, which is very big for a Quaker meeting, not so big for a Protestant church, but bigger than many congregations. We would not have ever thought that we could participate in housing development in the way that we have, and yet we've given significant money to this organization, which together with other monies made a difference.
The one thing I want to add about our network organizations, and in this particular study, all of the network organizations were evangelical, although we recognize that there would be network organizations that weren't. But the thing that distinguished it as a faith-based as opposed to your standard secular charismatic cycle is that really that faith, the faith base for whatever they were doing was very, very clear and suffused through the organization, even if it wasn't presented to the clients and even if there was no proselytizing. So what was happening is that people were, yes, indeed supporting this individual or this ministry, which might be one person or a small group, but it was all network. It was all, that, as you're saying, the social network.
Yeah. Where I've seen the issue in my opinion, go wrong is frequently in the area. It's not theology or practice. It tends to be in personnel choices.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I'm currently involved with a missionary organization. And it was fine when Bob and his wife and their children were missionaries. But now it's the brother-in-law and the sister-in-law and their children. And as a board, you start to wonder, you know, where's the line? Are we doing due diligence, governing?
Although the examples we had two that are extraordinarily strong. One is a crisis pregnancy center that's got, I think, three and centers now and is growing. And, you know, they're drawing volunteers, very small staff, but volunteers, not the kind of nepotism, but very similar, you know, everybody comes from the same faith tradition. But what's unique about these things when they're working well is they're drawing from virtual networks. You know, they're the ones that are getting